testing. One, two. Somebody say, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Now everybody say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
All right, y'all ready to get started tonight?
Yeah.
Hallelujah. We're going to get started and open up in a word of prayer. I'd like to ask everyone to please bow your heads and close your eyes if you would. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, we exalt you, Lord. We praise you. And we thank you for this beautiful day that we have had. And Father, for this beautiful night that we're about to partake in. And Father, we just exalt you in this place. We magnify you that you are God, and beside you there is no other. And Father, you promised in your word, where two or more are gathered in your name, there are you in the midst also. And we declare tonight that we gather together in this building in the name of Jesus, inviting the power of your Holy Spirit to come and speak into our hearts, that you would guide and direct this service tonight, that you would have your way, that you would begin to speak to our hearts. Father, as we push off the things of this world and we begin to focus our attention upon you, asking you, Lord, to let your kingdom come, let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Father, we just pray that the spirit of love and peace and joy, gentleness, kindness, and meekness will begin to flow throughout our hearts and flow throughout our lives. And Father, that you would have your way in this service tonight. Lord, we'll be sure to give you all the praise, the glory, and the honor, for it's in Jesus' name we pray. And all that would agree would say, amen. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. Let's give the Lord a hand clap tonight. Hallelujah. All right. I still have people coming in. If you all would please stand to your feet. And yes, I'm going to ask you to please smile. Kind of look smiling. Yeah, there we go. Yeah, smile. Now, if you would greet somebody that smile, tell them God loves them. You love them. You're glad they're in the house of God tonight.
Hey, Jim,
hallelujah.
There's still canned music, at least in the monitors up here.
Tell Stephanie's not here. Coming out past that beam there. A little grass all the way up there, so she'll probably win. That's a great job on the stump, though, man. That's impressive. I really was. Blew me away.
Blessed be the name of the Lord.
presence of the Lord, for he is worthy to be praised. Celebrate the presence of the Lord, for he is worthy to be praised. Rejoice in the Lord. Rejoice in the Lord. Rejoice.
Hallelujah. You may be seated. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Just have a few announcements, then we're going to take up an offering tonight. Some of you may know, some of you may not know, but we had a precious sister go home to be with the Lord this week. And, you know, my heart's real heavy about it. She was a soldier, a blessing. You know, words can't express, but some of y'all may know Stephanie Johnson, who is the black lady who always helps us out with the sound and the computer and my scriptures up on the screen and helps me with my microphone and has really been a great sidekick for me for a while. She was found deceased in her apartment on Monday. You know, no foul play seemed to be. It just something that happened. We're waiting on an autopsy to come back. But, you know, it's a sad thing. But I know is that she's in heaven. And I take great joy in that. I know that she's in heaven. If she didn't go to heaven, then we're all in trouble because she had a servant's heart. She loved people. I've heard a lot of reports and a lot of people just talking about how much she smiled, greeted them, loved on them, got to know them, was a part of their family. She was a part of our family for a few years now, and it just saddens my heart. But anyway, our service is going to be, her service is going to be February the 9th at 7 o'clock. It's on a Monday night. We're trying to make arrangements where everyone can come who'd like to come. And we're just going to have a celebration of her life and talk about Stephanie and minister the gospel and have a praise and worship time, because there's one thing I can say. She loved our church. Yes. From the moment she got here, she never let go. I could sit here and tell you stories how she had to press by a few people and, you know, she wanted to be involved. She wanted to help, and some people wouldn't let her help, and she just kept on wanting to help anyway, and she was determined she's going to help, and she did, too, and so I thank God for that. Amen. So in that, please be praying for her family. She does have a few family members that's still around, and her mother is still alive down in southeast part of Oklahoma. And also she has a son up in Chicago, I think it is, that we're still trying to find him, but also an aunt that's here local. So be praying for their family, and then praying for God's Shine Light Church. I need another Stephanie to come around. I need a helper to be a part. And so in that, y'all be praying for that as well. Amen. Also, I have a few other announcements. Do not forget, we have a men's clinic on March the 28th. We are looking for volunteers. We're also looking for clients or people who want to be involved in on the men's clinic on March the 28th, who needs an appointment. If you don't have medical insurance, you're a man, it's a male's clinic, a man's clinic. We will be having a women's clinic, I think, sometime in April or May. But in that, please sign up for an appointment, and that way we can get you in to see a doctor. It's basically a physical, discuss with the doctor any problems, any circumstance, situation. There's blood tests and all kinds of heart tests and things like that that's going to be going on. So please make plans to participate in that. And then also there's some other announcements, and I don't have a clue what they are, but we're getting there, all right? God, what is it? Oh, Sunday night. There you go, John. I knew there was something on my head. John Littrell wanted me to announce Sunday night they're having a sing-a-thon. Come on, if you're not going to watch the Super Bowl, this is a good place to be. I would say there's no better place to be except at God's Shine Light on Sunday night. But I know that's Jim's line, and he used it for Friday night. He stole it from you. Okay. Well, in that, I just want to encourage you, if you're a singer and you're interested in singing a song, get with Pastor John Littrell and let him know. I think there's a sign-up sheet out there for people to sign up for that. They're going to have a meal. So the meal starts at 5 o'clock. Is that right, John? And then they're going to have a sing-a-thon, and it'll last until everyone's through singing, as far as I know. And it's going to be a great time in the Lord. And I just encourage you to come out and participate with that as well. Do not forget to celebrate recovery on Tuesday nights. Do not forget Fabulous Friday night. And allow God to move in your life on Friday nights. God is growing. God is moving. And I just want to encourage you to come and participate in what God is doing at God Shining Light Church. We're getting ready to take up an offering. I'd like to read two scriptures and found in Proverbs chapter 3, verses 8 and 9, or actually 9 and 10. Proverbs 3, 9 and 10. It says, honor the Lord with your substance and with the first fruits of all your increase. So shall your barns be filled with plenty, and your presses, and your presses shall burst out with new wine. You can never outgive God, and we have to take up an offering. We do it every time we have a service. It's just to help support the church. If you want to pay your tithe tonight, you're more than welcome to. Give an offering. Give from the abundance of your heart. I promise you, God will give back into you, pressed down, shaken together, running over. He will bless you supernaturally. Could everyone say amen to that one?
Amen.
All right, let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Father, we exalt you tonight. We praise you. We thank you for this opportunity to give into the works of your kingdom. And Father, we just ask you to bless your people in a supernatural way. Father, we ask you to continue to move and show yourself strong. Bring finances from the north, the south, the east, and the west. Bring provision into their life. Supply all of their needs according to your riches and glory by Christ Jesus. That you honor your word, Father, as we give into the works of your kingdom. You will give back, pressed down, shaken together, running over into our lives. And Lord, we'll be sure to give you all the praise, the glory, and the honor. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. And all that would agree would say, amen. Amen and amen. Thank you as you give into the works of God's kingdom. Offering. There is one more announcement I have tonight. Donna Fawcett is not going to be here tonight. The ladies' class that she's teaching, she just asked me to invite them to stay in the sanctuary tonight and participate in here. I promise you, you will be blessed by staying here. There will be the leadership class. Maurice, are you teaching the IM class? And there will be the IM class tonight. So just be aware of that. Donna is recovering from the flu. That she got. We need to be praying for her, but she said she will be back next week, ready to go. So thank you so much.
Will you stand with me, please?
Is found in Him. Oh, let's worship.
Father, we praise you and we thank you for every heart, every person that's here. That you are our healer. You are our deliverer. You are the one who makes us whole. You lift up our hearts when they're heavy. And you bring peace and comfort into our innermost being. Father, we just pray over each and every person, the sound of my voice. You see all things, Father. You hear all things and you know all things. We just ask you to speak a word of healing, a word of comfort, a word of guidance and counsel, a word of direction. We may hear your voice and be yielded unto your will. Lord, let your kingdom come. Let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Lord, we'll be sure to give you all the praise, the glory, and the honor. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. And all that would agree would say, amen. 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 Hallelujah. You may be seated.
Thank you.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. One other announcement I'd like to announce, and I forgot about it. I remembered it. Some of y'all may remember Bart. Bart was a brother who actually lived behind the church for a little while, and he was a homeless guy, and he would go downtown and get beat up and come back to church, and, you know, he'd come sometimes, and we had to remove him a couple times because he was too drunk. But there was a time when he kept trying and kept trying, and the last time I spoke with him, he was going to get treatment, and then he was going to try and come back to Wings. But anyway, he also passed away. And he has a service tomorrow at 4 o'clock at Kennedy, down off of I-244, right past Peoria or Utica. At 4 o'clock, he's having a memorial service. And so I wanted to announce that as well. For some of you, you might want to come and support his family and be there for Bart. I'm hoping to try and go there myself. But anyway, you know, in war, we have casualties. And I know this, sometimes the battle's lost, but the war is won. Because Jesus won the war. Yeah, he holds the keys to death, hell, and the grave, and there ain't no one going to get out of his hand. Could everyone say amen to that?
Amen.
All right, this time we're going to dismiss the leadership class and the IM class, if you're involved in either one of those. Remember, ladies, if you're involved in Donna Fawcett's class, she just asked that you stay in the sanctuary this evening and allow us to entertain you. And I'm sure it's going to be an entertaining night. I just know it is. It's going to happen, but it's a great night, and it's a night that the Lord has made. And so we're going to get started and get into the Word a little bit. I have a scripture I want to read, and then I want to emphasize a couple of things, and I'm going to turn it over to my wife to talk for a moment before we watch a video tonight. How many of y'all enjoyed the video last week? Amen. You're going to enjoy this one tonight as well. I promise you that. It's very entertaining and very good for information. Scripture I'd like to read is in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 33. It says, "Nevertheless, let every one of you in particular so love his wife even as himself, and the wife see that she reverence her husband." We're working on relationships. Relationships is something that you have to work on periodically at all times. No matter how long you've been married or how short a time you've been married, there's a time that you just really got to take and you got to work on it. You got to grow together. You know, I've seen many people get married and wind up having lots of struggles because they don't know each other. You know, fortunately, my wife and I have been together for about 30 years and we know each other. Actually, 31 years to be exact. But she says 30, I say 31. You know, hey, who's counting, right? In that we've been through a lot of things, and this is the first time that we have actually joined together as a team and taught a lesson or taught a class or taught about marriage and relationship. And in the process, I knew that we would be working on our relationship, and oh boy, we've been working on our relationship. Wonderful place. It's good. How good do you want your relationships to be? Some of you may be single here tonight, and you're getting ready to get into a relationship, or you want a relationship, you're in the right place. Because, let me ask you this, do you know what marriage is? And you say, yeah, I know what it is. Are you sure? How many have you had? Okay. How many of them have been successful? Do you understand what it's like? There is a reason why they call marriage an institution, but that's on both sides. Okay. Keep that in mind, because whenever you share, you become as one. And you walk together and you talk together. In that, we've asked all of you to do a few things. We passed out some paperwork. If you don't have one or don't have the paper, let's see where mine is. The first one we passed out, we're going to be going through these other books. Right now, we're dealing with love and respect. We're getting ready to start going through Men Are Like Waffles and Women Are Like Spaghetti. And then we're going to also go through the 5 love languages. And we're going to go through, well, I say we're going to go through, we keep talking about the power of a praying wife and the power of a praying husband. In that, we've asked you to do a few things. Number one, pray one for another. Pray one for another. Out loud to where the other one can hear what the other one is saying. It is very, very important that your spouse hears you pray for them. There's something that it does on the inside that really empowers you, blesses you, equips you, and helps you to to accomplish the things that God would have you to do. And if you don't know how to pray, there's two excellent books. One of them is The Power of a Praying Wife. The other one's The Power of a Praying Husband. Years ago in 2002, when my wife and I went through counseling, the counselor, one of the first things he said was for us to pray one for another. And we struggled in what to pray for. You know, even though I've been a Christian for a few years and my wife had too, we really didn't know how to pray for one another. So we got the books and we started reading the prayers over each other. And they are really good prayers. Amen. So I encourage you to do that and be praying for one another. The next thing I ask, if you're in a relationship and you're married, to be giving each other a 30-minute couch time. 30 minutes a day that you talk. I know some say, I ain't gonna do that. I already see rebellion going on already. No, hey, try it. I promise you, if you'll begin to talk, even recently when my wife and I began to talk again, we're communicating. We're talking about what bothers each other, what affects each other, what happens. And a few weeks ago, I shared a part about the towel, and she shared about the coat hanging on the staircase. And you know, we talked about communicating and how it bothered one another and how the reason why we did. It wasn't just to aggravate her. It was for my comfort. And, of course, she has a blanket that she uses, and sometimes it's not folded, and it aggravates me. She didn't do it to aggravate me. She just didn't think it bothered me. And so things like that that you communicate about. We also gave a piece of paper, and I think my wife's going to talk a little bit about it, wherever it may be. Hold up. About some guidelines in your talk time. Okay? If you don't have these pieces of paper, you would like them tonight before we leave. We can make sure we get copies. Some guidelines to follow, some questions to ask. I want to encourage you. Be careful when you're on your couch time. If you seem to start fighting, then take a time out, okay, and then come back to your couch time. But please communicate. Work on your relationship. It will not work if you don't work on it. It's a job. It's a job to have a relationship. And, the guy last week on the video, he plainly said, we was made to have conflict. Yeah, I couldn't believe he said that. I really could, but then I realized why my wife and I have had conflict for so many years. It's so we can make up. I thought it was good. I mean, that's what I thought. Maybe she didn't think that, but that's what I thought. As a man, we have them brains, you know? So in that, I just encourage you to get the books. I encourage you to pray for one for another. I ask you to just be encouraged along the way, and I hope that you enjoy the class. And let me... I have a microphone for my wife. Are you ready? You ready to share? Okay. Tonight, my wife is opening up as well. So here you go. Y'all give her a nice round of applause. Isn't she beautiful? Yeah. I love her. Look at her. I'm going to embarrass her just a little bit. Look at her smile. She's beautiful, isn't she? Okay.
Unfortunately, some of the stuff that Dixie talked about is some of the stuff I wanted to talk about is the fact that marriage is work. It's in that once we realize that Dixie preaches a lot about, even in our staff meetings and stuff, that we're team players and that each of us have roles to play in that team. We start out as a team working together, but we both start out on the same path and the same journey, and we're going to go down the same road, but because women have a different perspective than what men do, a lot of times we end up realizing that even though that we're going down the same road and we're both have the desire to get to a certain point back there where, say we're backups at, we want to get there, but there's a lot of different ways to get there. So women may go one way to get there and a man may go another way to get there, but we're both trying to go to the same place. And so in our journey with being married, we have to figure out and come back and talk about and realize that we're both on the same track. We're both going the same direction. We just have a different idea and concept on how to get there. So that's part of what it is. How many of you guys have noticed this week that when your wives are talking, how they were spider webbing? Did anybody realize that right off the bat when did you realize the spider web? Did you
say spider webbing?
Spider webbing.
Spider web. Yeah. Man, did you recognize it?
Did you guys recognize it?
Okay.
You
know? All right.
But when you recognized it, did you say, "Oh, she's trying to connect," and stop and listen to the aspect of where she was at, or did you just let the points go in and out? You got confused. Davey, it is very, very hard for you to function.
Davey, it's never mind. Go ahead.
We pray for Davey on a regular basis because not only do we have it's difficult. He's a character all in itself. But in that way, you know, women, how many times have you found yourself spiderwebbing this week and trying to realize, it's like, okay, maybe I need to tone it down and not have 10 spider points, only maybe 3. You know, how many times did you stop yourself and say, okay, I need to let my husband catch up? it's like maybe I just need to slow down just a little bit because he's a little bit behind. He got that glazed over look, you know, it's like, okay, he went to his nothing box.
Like my nothing box.
So anyway, those are things that we liked about it. On two occasions we had some friends that sent these video to spouses or other people that weren't in the class, and the girl was asking, "Did you listen to that? Did you watch that video? Did you watch that video? Did you watch that video?" And she just kept asking question after question and question. And finally, the one thing that most men got out of the video is, your mom is on the roof. So we're like, okay, yeah, he watched it because, you know, the mom was on the roof. Anyway, in this one, ladies, you're going to find some areas that, I can't even remember his name now. Emerson talks about that is going to give us some correction on some things we need to do. So let's sit back and watch what he has to say about that.
Here, hold on. We have to pass out the pink papers. Now, last week, we had the blue papers, okay? We still have a few left. The blue was, are you looking? Men, we look through everything with blue sunglasses, okay? Women look through everything with pink sunglasses. It's their perception of what is going on. There's nothing wrong with perception, okay? If there's any men who would like, or anyone who wasn't here last week, who would like a blue sheet, we'll pass those out as well. Here you go, Brandon, help me out. If you want a blue sheet, raise your hand. Pink sheets, they're going to pass out to everyone. I hope we have enough to cover. Before we watch the video, huh? Let me say, everyone who wants a pink sheet needs a pink sheet. The pink sheet covers the video tonight. It will help be a reminder for you. If you wasn't here last week and you would like to watch the video that we watched last week, which covered the blue sheet, we can get you that link on YouTube and make it happen. Yes. Last week is actually on the website. I have a few of them. Yes, Sandy. On our GSL church website. Okay. Huh? Okay, there's the more of the blue ones. Okay, that's all I have. On the GSL church website, for some of you who would like to go back and watch last Wednesday's, Dre, we have them on the website. Is that right? The recordings? I believe my wife, yeah, the recording is on there. My wife pulled it up. She was listening to me talk last week. I said, what are you listening to? Because it sounds so good. You know what? I said, no, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding, okay? And in that, she said, I'm watching you from last week trying to remember what you'd said, opening up. And so if you want to watch it last week, it's on the website. We can get you the link to the video. I promise you, that video last week was so good. It was good. And if you didn't get anything but the last point, brothers, men, okay, or ladies, it was the point about the mother-in-laws on the roof, okay? And so I just encourage you be aware. You know, I do know this. If you give your wives, men, if you give your wives a chance to talk, they will solve all their problems. And they won't want you to solve anything. And you'll be the hero, okay? You'll be the hero. Now, if they ask you to fix it, be glad to fix it. But if they don't, maybe you just got to listen. Now, here in a few weeks when we start Men Are Like Waffles, Women Like Spaghetti, tonight we was, you know, looking at a couple of the videos that's coming up on that. And the guy was just, I mean, I just laughed because of what he said. He said, you know, ladies, for any time a man is sitting there listening and all of a sudden he has a glaze that goes over his face, don't worry about it. It's just he went to his place called nothing. Okay? And it happens, and if you'll give him a little time, he'll come back. So it's a good video. I'm excited about getting into that in the next few weeks. Did everyone get sheets, or do we still need to make copies? On blue or pink? Pink? On both. Okay. All right. Well, what we will do is once the copies are made, we will pass them out to you, huh? Yeah, we can still start the video. I want to go ahead and start because in that way we can have plenty of time to talk afterwards for a moment, okay? Bill, would you go ahead and lower the lights and begin the video?
Now, each of these letters represents a biblical teaching. Each of these concepts, C-H-A-I-R-S, illustrates something very, very powerful. I want to begin with C, and it's called conquest. Doesn't that sound romantic? Conquest. Appreciating his desire to work and achieve. Listen to Genesis 2:15. The Lord God took the man and put him into the Garden of Eden to cultivate and keep it. Again, Genesis 2:15. The Lord God took the man, this is Adam, and put him into the Garden of Eden to cultivate and keep it. This is in paradise. Is Eve created at this time? Yes or no? No, she's not around. So why did God create Adam? He created Adam to work in paradise. What's the first question that every man asks another man when they meet for the first time? What do you do? It's called the instrumentality of the male. Men have to have an instrument in their hands. You know, in fact, they've had little girls stand in front of a mirror like 5 years old and they're videotaping her. She doesn't know it. There's nothing else in the room other than this floor-length mirror. And for 100% of the time, she'll talk to herself in the mirror. Then they bring a little 5-year-old boy into that room, right? Take her out, and he's in front of this mirror. What's he do? He starts talking to himself. Then suddenly he goes, we're back to the ceiling fans. You can put a little boy out on a pile of dirt and he'll watch those bulldozers for 2 hours. Little girls are running through the airports with dolls under their hands, not little boys. There's something within our nature that God has done something. And it's not wrong, it's just different. Missy says to Stu, I'm sick and tired of you choosing work over the family. You get up early and come home late. You don't care about me or the kids. Yes, I got your message about your promotion, but I don't care. This is all about you. It's always about you. You seem to have fun all day long and give me very little of yourself. And when you are home, you fall asleep watching TV. I'm fed up with this existence. We never talk. You always find time for what is important to you. You need to make me feel more important. Well, I'm thinking about going back to school, and you're going to need to support me in this. We're talking about this tonight. Right now, you need to pick up the kids from their lessons, and you need to take the check over to Molly Maid's because I forgot to pay them for cleaning because I stayed too long at the athletic club today. You talk about spinning on the crazy cycle. Bam, bam, bam. You're saying something to him, and you can be at a PMS moment and justify it, pre-murder syndrome. But you're attacking his spirit in a huge way. Huge, huge. In fact, I had this gal we know that real good friends, and she just got, oh, you have to hear me talk about this. She replayed it. She said it was right before Christmas, and all the women in our neighborhood, their husbands had great professions. My husband was on staff at the university. He had a great income, but it wasn't. He was fixed in his income. And so she said all these gals were going to go over and spend money in this big city area rather than their own hometown where they could have got it for half price. So I just started telling, can you believe it? Those husbands are writing blank checks. They're going to go over and spend the whole day spending twice what they needed. She's just going on and on and on about what these women are going to do. And his spirit just went down, 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 down. And then she was done. He got up, went into a study, shut the door, and didn't come out the rest of the evening. She just saw his spirit completely sink. And then she heard me. And so she went back to him and she said, that night that I brought that up, did you think I was saying that those men are better men than you are and those women had it better than I did? That's exactly what you were saying to me. In fact, some women are saying, but, well, we want to have a career, we want to work. Well, I'm going to share with you, your husband feels a call to the field. He doesn't see it as an option. Women, even though they want career, they still want it to be freedom of choice issue. In fact, young teenage girls are still looking for a man strong enough to take her out of the workforce if she wants to get out of the workforce. Still, even with the Cinderella complex, you need a man like you, a fish needs a bicycle, you know, the whole mantra of the feminist movement and the whole mindset out there, they're going to divorce you anyway, get a career and so on and so forth. But these girls still want to marry someone strong enough. Why? Because these girls aren't stupid. They love children. And if they want to have three children, they don't want to be told they have to work plus have a family. They want the freedom of choice. Men, on the other hand, feel they have to work. In fact, I love Tim Allen, the comedian of Home Improvement, says, today women have all kinds of choices. They can be married without children, without career. They can be unmarried with children, with career. They can be unmarried without children, without career. I mean, the choices for women are endless. It goes on and on and on. The choices are endless. Men, they only have two choices, work or go to jail. Now, here's what you can do. Just send him a note. Just write him a little note. You know, I was thinking of you that you have to work. I just want to say thank you. That's all you have to do. That isn't romantic to you, I understand. That doesn't make sense to you. But I'm going to tell you, that can be very deep. That's all you have to do. Thank you for working. I don't think I understand the dog-eat-dog world that you're in. I don't think I understand the pressure that you feel and the comparisons that are made to you. Thank you for providing. You watch what happens. So, C is conquest. H is hierarchy. Isn't this romantic? Hierarchy. Hierarchy, his desire to provide and protect and even die. Deborah Tannen, the great linguist, says this in her book, You Just Don't Understand, Women and Men in Conversation. Having done the research that led to this book, I now see that my husband was simply engaging the world in a way that many men do. As an individual in a hierarchical, there it is, hierarchical social order in which he was either one up or one down. Men see themselves in terms of rankings. Look at the business arena, CEO, vice presidents, managers. Look at the military, the four-star general, three-star, two colonel, on down majors, sergeants, so on and so forth. You see it in the government, president, vice president. That reflects the male psyche. We function very well as long as there's mutual honor and justice. But when there's dishonor and unfairness, you've got revolt. But men come to a point where they say, he's a 10-talent man, I'm a 7-talent man. I don't want all his responsibilities, but if this 10-talent man says to the 7-talent man, I can't do this job without you, man, I need you. Don't ever leave me, because they'll all know I'm a failure. I need you. And then what can I do? Are you compensated well here? I have two commitments, to honor you and treat you justly, because if I lose you, everybody's going to know that you are behind this thing. Will you talk about loyalty, service, and dying? We come to a point where we function extremely well in that. We don't always like to be second sometimes, but we come to a point where we say, that's okay. In fact, I love this role, and that's all right. And we function with high energy. But see, we are hierarchical. So when you confront your husband to connect, sit down and talk to me, sit down. He hears you confront to control. He thinks it's one up. He says, quit picking a fight. You're just provoking me. Leave me alone. Why are you doing this? And you're just trying to connect. You're trying to couple. And he thinks you're trying to chair things to wear the pants. And that's why you say, you're just going to do what you want to do anyway, and you just always want to wear the pants in this family. And you think, wear the pants? What are you talking about? What planet are you from? I can't believe you talked to me this. You talk about confusion. Both are coming at it from pink and blue. But I'm going to tell you, your husband feels a responsibility to provide for you, to protect, and to be that umbrella of protection over you. It's a huge feeling that he has. Women and children first. Yes. We die. 1 Timothy 5:8 says, if anyone does not provide for his own, and especially for those of his own household, he is denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. That's how men view other men. We see this as a responsibility, not as a right. But you know, the feminist movement, though they're good-willed women in that thing, and they're intellectual women, they have seen this attitude in men that's really, truthfully, a sense of responsibility. They've read that as a sense of right. You men want to dominate. No, men want to be responsible. You see it as a right. No, we see it as a responsibility. Men have, I've never had any meeting where men says, isn't it great that we have these rights? That has never gone down as a conversation. Men don't even process it that way. I'm telling you, there are two different cultures. The culture of women and all the talk that's going on, and the culture of men. And they are not the same. Men just don't think in those terms. They just feel like we must be responsible. And if we aren't, we're viewed as irresponsible. That's just the way it is in our world. That's why the headship ideas become so provocative to some women. Ephesians 5, 23 and 24. For the husband is the head of the wife. What does that mean? As Christ also is the head of the church. Whatever else it means, it must include and be restricted by whatever Christ is in relationship to the church. But then notice what it says. He, Jesus himself, being the savior of the body. What's he talking about? He dies. What does it mean to be the head? We die. This is a responsibility, not a right. Headship is a responsibility. Why can't we understand what the scriptures mean? And we have people telling us that it means a right. It does not mean a right. And men don't process it as a right. Women process it as a right because you see an attitude of independence. And especially when he feels disrespected, he gets stubborn. And you see him trying to dominate and shut you off and try to control you. But that isn't where it's coming from. He's trying to send a message, I don't feel respected by you right now. He's not thinking, I'm going to control this woman. Your son is going to do this toward your daughter-in-law. Mark my words. I know what I speak is truth. He's a good-willed boy who's going to react this way and be completely misinterpreted and misunderstood if we don't change the course. E.V. Hill, the great African-American pastor, Jim Dobson was interviewing him, and he recalls when he was first a pastor, they just had started. He and Jane were in the ministry, and they were really struggling. And he came home one night, and as he came into the house, the house was dark, and he comes into the dining area, and there's candlelights in the dinner. And Jane is standing there smiling at him. He says, what's going on? I thought we'd eat by candlelight. Hey, great, I'll wash my hands. So he goes into the bathroom, flips on the lights, and they don't come on. So he goes back to Jane and says to her, the lights didn't come on. And she starts crying. You work so hard, and we're trying, but it's pretty rough. I didn't have enough money to pay the light bill. I didn't want you to know about it, so I thought we would just eat by candlelight. And Dr. Hill described his wife's words with intense emotion. She could have said, I've never been in this situation before. I was reared in the home of Dr. Kalavas, and we never had our lights cut off. She could have broken my spirit. She could have ruined me. She could have demoralized me. But instead, she said, somehow or other, we'll get these lights back on. But tonight, let's eat by candlelight. You see what I'm talking about here? Men are extremely vulnerable and sensitive to certain things that you women are clueless about at times. I did a company, they had their six vice presidents and the president, they asked Sarah and me to come do a private conference for them. During the intermission of one of the times, one of the vice president's wife came up and said, we got a story for you. We just built this wonderful new home. One of my wife's girlfriends, kind of a distant friend, but a friend, wanted to take the cook's tour of our new home. So we said, sure. She said, can I bring my husband over? I said, sure. So we were halfway through the tour, coming down the steps, when suddenly this wife stops at the steps, turns around, puts her finger in her husband's chest and says, you need to get a second job. And stomped right on down and went into another room. The husband was absolutely devastated. They saw him turn white. His spirit just sank. And on the way home, I'm going to tell you, when he's driving, he's going to go, I can't believe how you hurt me in front of those people. I just can't believe it. He's not going to do that. He's going to white knuckle that steering wheel. He's not going to have sex with a drill instructor for 6 weeks. He's going to get angry. And of course, she's going to start videotaping right there. And take the videotape to the pastor, to the counselor, to her mother, to her sister, and all her girlfriends. See how he treats me? See how he treats me? And I'm getting emails all over America. They start telling me this story right there. They start filming in pink. This is what he does to me. And I said, man, he is irrational. He just does that? Well, no. I mean, I said, tell me, did anything happen prior? And women will always tell me, because they're not mean, and they're really not trying to hide anything. They just don't take it seriously. They think he should understand, he should be big enough and tough enough. For heaven's sakes, he's 6'3" and 214 pounds. He should be able to take it. He should know I'm ventilating. Your baby boy is gonna just die. And they'll always tell me, well, when I was on the steps, I said he needed to get a second job, put my finger in, I go, now that I think about it, that was really horrible. And then they suddenly see it. This is what's so tender and wonderful about women. They suddenly see it. Now, some of you women are suddenly
President
going,
Obama
oh, no.
Obama said that he and Hagel were always on the same page.
Oh, no. You're only 2 points in, and I'm already feeling like I'm a miserable creep, and we got four more after this. Oh, no. Oh, it's me. Oh, no. I've been blaming him. It is me. It's me.
Hey, listen to me. All you have to say to him, very simple, go to him and say,
I realize I've been so disrespectful. It's me. It's me. I thought you were so unloving. And there are things, but it's me. It's really, I'm disrespectful. I've ruined the relationship.
Do you mean that?
Yeah, I do.
You're just probably saying it.
No, it's really me. It's me. I'm horrible. I'm rotten. I'm rotten.
You really believe that?
It's me. Yeah, I've ruined the relationship.
Then alert Google to tell them it's there. Drop it. Forget it. The game is on. Here's your Pepsi. Let's go watch.
Storm Lab. Friend will arrive tonight. That will usher in some cooler conditions.
See, you're not married to a man who's as loving as you, but you're married to a man who's honorable.
It will still be cool with highs in the lower mid-50s. North winds about 55 miles per hour. Cold again Thursday night, Friday morning, lows in the mid-12 or 20s. I'm Tulsa's channel lead meteorologist Mike Collier and Tulsa's Talk Radio 1170 KFAQ.
Talk Radio 1170 KFAQ is your home for OSU football. Each and every game, plus the Mike Gundy Coaches Show. Spend the season with us.
Driven by your Oklahoma Ford dealers, the best in Oklahoma. And American Heritage Bank, simply better banking. And by Oklahoma Men's Clinic, Oklahoma's male sexual health expert.
I know I'm not all, but you can hear me, can't you, Sandy? Yes, praise the Lord. Thank you, Sandy. All right. I don't know what Bill did. We're going to have to fire Bill, but that's all right. Hold up. I am missing Stephanie already. I'm missing Stephanie really bad. You just don't know. We do need them, but Bill's not going to go nowhere. I'll fire him and he'll show up tomorrow. I've tried firing him and he shows right back up. He walks out one door and he'll come back in the other door. He's not going anywhere. I'm not paying attention. Maybe I'm.
Oh, no. You're only 2 points in, and I'm already feeling like I'm a miserable creep, and we got four more after this. Oh, no.
Oh, it's me. Oh, no. I've been blaming him. It is me. It's me.
Hey, listen.
Find it a little bit, Bill.
All you have to say to him, very simple, go to him and say,
I realize I've been so disrespectful. It's
all zeros. Or visit online at CordellCordell.com. That's CordellCordell.com. Offices in Tulsa, Oklahoma City.
It's Davey's fault.
Cordell and Cordell. 320 South Boston.
I know it's Davey's fault.
Tulsa, Oklahoma, 74.
Everyone agree it's Davey's fault? Raise your hand.
Juniors and seniors.
All right. He can't see. It's okay. Be nice to who, Davey?
Just by earning all A's and B's. Log on to FocusTulsa.com with your report card and sign up. 1170 KFAQ and Bob Hurley Ford. Special thanks to Eaton Square Cinema and Super Saver Cinema for their support.
Today's sponsor. You work so hard and we're trying, but it's pretty rough. I didn't have enough money to pay the light bill. I didn't want you to know about it, so I thought we would just eat by candlelight. And Dr. Hill described his wife's words with intense emotion. She could have said, I've never been in this situation before. I was reared in the home of Dr. Koalas, and we never had our lights cut off. She could have broken my spirit. She could have ruined me. She could have demoralized me. But instead, she said, somehow or other, we'll get these lights back on. But tonight, let's eat by candlelight. You see what I'm talking about here? Men are extremely vulnerable and sensitive to certain things that you women are clueless about at times. I did a company, they had their 6 vice presidents and the president, they asked Sarah and me to come do a private conference for them. During the intermission of one of the times, one of the vice president's wife came up and said, we got a story for you. We just built this wonderful new home. One of my wife's girlfriends, kind of a distant friend, but a friend, wanted to take the cook's tour of our new home. So we said, sure. She said, can I bring my husband over? I said, sure. So we were halfway through the tour, coming down the steps, when suddenly this wife stops at the steps, turns around, puts her finger in her husband's chest and says, you need to get a second job. And stomped right on down and went into another room. The husband was absolutely devastated. They saw him turn white, his spirit just sank. And on the way home, I'm going to tell you, when he's driving, he's going to go, I can't believe how you hurt me in front of those people. I just can't believe it. He's not going to do that. He's going to white knuckle that steering wheel. He's not going to have sex with a drill instructor for 6 weeks. He's going to get angry. And of course, she's going to start videotaping right there. And take the videotape to the pastor, to the counselor, to her mother, to her sister, and all her girlfriends. See how he treats me? See how he treats me? And I'm getting emails all over America. They start telling me this story right there. They start filming in pink. This is what he does to me. And I said, man, he is irrational. He just does that? Well, no. I mean, I said, tell me, did anything happen prior? And women will always tell me, because they're not mean, and they're really not trying to hide anything. They just don't take it seriously. They think he should understand he should be big enough and tough enough. For heaven's sakes, he's 6'3" and 214 pounds. He should be able to take it. He should know I'm ventilating. Uh-uh. Your baby boy is going to just die. And they'll always tell me, well, when I was on the steps, I said he needed to get a second job, put my finger in, now that I think about it, that was really horrible. And then they suddenly see it. This is what's so tender and wonderful about women. They suddenly see it. Now, some of you women are suddenly going, Oh, no.
You're only 2 points in, and I'm already feeling like I'm a miserable creep, and we got 4 more after this. Oh, no. Oh, it's me. Oh, no. I've been blaming him, and it's me.
Hey, listen to me. All you have to say to him, very simple. Go to him and say,
I realize I've been so disrespectful. It's me. It's me. I thought you were so unloving, and there are things, but it's me. It's really, I'm disrespectful. I've ruined the relationship.
Do you mean that?
Yeah, I do.
You're just probably saying that.
No, it's really me. It's me. I'm horrible. I'm rotten.
You really believe that?
It's me. Yeah, I've ruined the relationship.
Hey, drop it. Forget it. The game is on. Here's your Pepsi. Let's go watch. So you're not married to a man who's as loving as you, but you're married to a man who's honorable. You're not married to a woman who's respectful as you, but you're married to a loving person. And we have to come to a point that God intended that to be a compliment. God's not pink, God's not blue, God's purple. When you put pink and blue together, it's purple, the color of royalty. God created us in his image. Male and female, he created. That really tickled you that it's purple. Didn't know. But God created us that way, to complement, to ultimately reflect his image. Not wrong, just different. And coming to a point where some of you ladies realize you're married to a man of honor. He doesn't have to say, we need to talk about this tonight and tomorrow. What did you mean when you said this back in 1983 when you didn't respect me? And you had that stupid green sweater on that I didn't like. He doesn't even go there. He can't even remember that decade. Just drop it, forget it, let's move on. Which you hate at certain times when you're wanting to bring it full circle. When you have a need, you want him to come full circle. But I'm going to tell you, there are other times when you need to thank God that that's the way he is. Because when you seek his forgiveness for being disrespectful, he didn't have a need to talk about it for 3 hours. He didn't want to talk, which is something you criticize him for. But you have a strength there. And every strength has a backsided weakness. You got to see that everything that irritates you also is an incredible gift. Every rose has thorns. You've got to come to the bigger picture. And when you do, you can roll with this a little bit more. Yeah, it hurts us, it offends us, but see that there's some deep nugget of wisdom that God has given to you in this moment of irritation. There's got to be a rose here somewhere, because I just got pricked by a thorn. C is conquest, H is hierarchy, A is authority. Now, if there are any angels in this auditorium, they've just fled. Angels fear to go where I'm about to go with this word authority. But let me just share with you why I use the word authority. It's a biblical idea, but also we just established the fact that your husband feels primarily responsible for you. So here's what I'm going to ask you. Do you believe he's at least 51% responsible for you? If you don't, if you just take an egalitarian position, we're 50-50 responsible, then don't expect him to necessarily always open the door for you and be nice. That's why the feminist movement is trying to be consistent and why it can be sexual harassment in a business if a man opens a door for a woman. I mean, they realize the logic of their system has to go all the way. That's why they're pursuing women in combat. They know that the philosophy of their system has to go toward absolute equality. But there's a real discomfort with that because there's a recognition that there are some differences. So we're at an interesting point. But you're going to have to decide. Are you an absolute egalitarian? If you are, then you don't have to listen to me. You can sleep. But if you're here and you believe that your husband is responsible to die for you tonight if a burglar comes in, and I'm going to tell you, the responsibility to die for somebody is no small issue. Would you listen to me? This is not a small issue. This is humongous. And men feel it. They feel it deep within their hearts. And he knows he would die for you, only to hear every day that you don't love me, you don't love me. When Jesus said, no greater love is a man than this, he laid down his life for his friend. But then you say, you don't love me, you don't love me. It's kind of like, what? Man. He's confused, but he feels that. Now, if you believe this, then here's what I want to share with you. Leadership 101 says this. Let's say Monday you go to work and you have 1,000 employees, and the board meets and says, hey, we want you to be the CEO of this thing. We're going to pay you $2 million salary, $10 million bonus. You're responsible for everything in this organization. Do you want it? Oh, yes! Oh, by the way, you have authority to do nothing. What are we setting that person up for? Failure. We know this. We know this because it's a violation of Leadership 101. If you hold somebody primarily responsible, you must give them equal authority to that responsibility. If you say to somebody, you're responsible, but I have the authority. If you're going around saying, you can't do that, we're equal. You can't do that, we're equal. You can't do that, we're equal. And at the same time, in the truth of it, you're holding him 51% responsible. You're then saying, you're responsible, but I have veto power. I have the authority as the woman. We're equal. You can't do that. You're not saying you're equal. You're living a whole life saying you're 51% responsible, but if you make a decision contrary to what I want, I'm going to tell you, you can't do that. And you know what he's going to do? He's going to be feeling like a failure. And I will tell you that the person who's getting that $2 million salary and a $10 million bonus, he'll finally say, you know, I'm not quitting because I'm going to collect this paycheck, but I'm moving into passive irresponsibility. Does anybody see passive irresponsibility among men and families and marriages? It's an epidemic. Why? Because we violated Leadership 101. But you need to see that he sees himself as a man. 1 Corinthians 16:13, act like men, be strong. 1 Kings 2:2, be strong, therefore, and show yourself a man. And Dr. Deborah Tannen said men are taller, more heftily built, lower pitched voice. She calls these markers of authority, whereas women are smaller, slighter, and high pitched voice. And what happens sometimes because of that, you up the ante. You get overly negative, overly emotional to try to make the case. And you think he should know why you're doing that. And it just is overkill because all the message is saying we're equal, equal. And then it's kind of like you're trying to be more equal and he gets confused and he just gives up and goes, turns on the TV and just stonewalls you. But if you come to him and say, will you forgive me? I dishonored you. I'm not trying to exercise authority. It's such a precious thought that you would die for me. And it's right. Leadership 101 is right. Trust my heart. Please forgive me. He's going to say, hey, the alligator man is on. Let's watch it together. And I just recommend that you do what Sarah and I've done. We decided when we got married that I would make all the major decisions. She would make all the minor decisions. And that's worked great since 1973. We've not had a major decision yet. I say to Sarah, is that one? No, that's minor. Is that a major? No, that's minor. What about this one? No, minor. C is conquest, H is hierarchy, A is authority, I is insight. Appreciating his desire to analyze and counsel. Men are solution-oriented, that we score higher in general on the aptitudes, women on the verbal side, not wrong, just different. These are skills and strengths that God has provided, but he tends to be more solution-oriented. Not all men are. The constants are love and respect. Some women stonewall, some men do not. That's a cultural application, but the constants are love and respect. If you stonewall as a woman, my conclusion is if you love him, he's going to feel disrespected. He's not going to feel you don't love him. And if you come at her too much talking all the time, it's not that she's going to feel disrespected. Ultimately, she's going to say, if you love me, you give me more space. So the constants are love and respect. The variables are these applications. So understand, there's not a reversal. The cultural applications do not prove that you somehow are in violation of Scripture. Go deeper. You'll see the constants. But here's a cultural application. Men tend to be solution-oriented, and women are more verbal on that side of it. And when men have problems, and they come to one another, I come to Joe and I say, hey, Joe, I've been thinking about this, this, and this. I've got this problem. Joe immediately kicks into solution. He said, well, did you think about this, or what about this, or did you try this and this and this? No, man, I should have come to you 2 weeks ago. Thanks. I don't say to him, Joe, you quit trying to fix me. That never would even enter a man's mind. It just, we see it as helpful. You're giving me a solution because I came to you with a problem. When we come to another man with a problem, we kick into solution. So your wife comes to you with a problem, we kick into solution mode, only to be told, quit trying to fix me. And I said last night, we got to be less solution-oriented and more empathy-oriented. Nonetheless, there comes a moment when you come to your husband, you want him to validate your feelings. Just validate my feelings. Just listen to me. And he's thinking, but those feelings aren't valid. Does he have the right to tell you that? And in this culture at this time, no, he does not. That's what the culture's saying. Women are right, men are wrong. Women are righteous, men are unrighteous. I'm telling you, this is deeply disturbing. Where do women sin today? They sin in reaction to their husband, who isn't loving. They sin when they're exhausted with their children. But every other issue, it's not gluttony, it's an eating disorder. It's a chemical imbalance. It's not an outburst of anger. If you look at all the things, we've psychologically interpreted all of your issues. Where do you sin? Now, you're very confessional in bad attitudes and so on and so forth, but usually that's triggered by somebody else, isn't it? And if they would just change a little bit, you would outlove them. I say this not because I'm trying to shame you, but I want to share something with you. Your husband sees you as righteous. He knows you don't struggle with what he does. He's in tune with his dark side, I'm telling you, big time. He knows sexual temptations. You are naive about what he's aware of. He just sees the dark side. He knows it. Eve was deceived. Adam disobeyed. And that's a big difference. And the Bible says in 1 Timothy 2:14, Eve was deceived, not Adam. Adam was very conscious of his dark side. He knew what he was doing. But Eve got duped. She didn't see her sin. And what I'm going to tell you is your husband sees himself as unrighteous. He sees you as righteous. But here's something interesting. There comes a moment when you see him. You catch him on the internet with pornography. You would never go that way because you don't have that temptation. So you judge him, and you're threatened at the core of your being. I understand what's really going on there, but boy, do you come at him. And so you catch him in unrighteousness. And then there comes this moment when you see yourself as more righteous than him. And let me share with you, the number one sin that Jesus confronted was the self-righteous religious person. Because they don't see themselves as sinners. Jesus said in Luke 18:9, he told this parable to certain ones who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and viewed others with contempt. You view your husbands with contempt, it could be that you see yourself as self-righteous. Now, why do I bring this up? To shame you? No. I'm going to tell you, though, you cannot be intimate with a self-righteous person. You want to know why your husband's closed off? He's afraid of you. Does he tell you that he's afraid of you? No. Mm-mm. That just feels too effeminate to him. And he's not afraid of you in a broader scope, but he is fearful. But he's not going to tell you that. It's just too hard for him. He cannot open up. And if he did open up and tell you his sin, what would you do in response to that? You see, women want men to be open today, but only if it increases the feelings of love between them. But if he were to confess his deep dark side and it threatened you at the core of your being and it was an area that you didn't struggle with, you'd judge him. You want to know why your husband is shutting down? You want to know why he's coming across in unloving ways? He's not trying to be unloving. If you've sent a series of messages, I despise who you are, I have contempt for who you are, I disrespect who you are, particularly because you're doing things that I would never do, and you're threatening me at the core of my being, which means you're very unloving as well, what do you expect your baby boy to do in relationship to a daughter-in-law who sends that message to him? He simply will freeze. He is not going to know what to do other than get angry. And then they'll videotape him. And he'll be divorced. 50% divorce rate in a church right now, and it's going to continue unless we stop this, and your grandchildren are going to be crying themselves to sleep at night and wetting the bed. You're going to go through so much pain, and the pain is continuing to increase unless something, God does something in His grace and mercy and brings a change. And I'm believing and trusting that He's going to do that as we come back to His truth that He's revealed from His heart. Diane confessed she merely put down her husband. She mocked his ideas and his reactions or responses and secretly made fun of his opinions. One day when she visited him at his office, she was struck by the tremendous respect his co-workers, his secretary, and his boss showed him. She shared how she got a knot in her stomach when she heard a man who was older and more experienced than her husband say yes to him. And she was both frightened and ashamed when she saw how his young secretary looked up and admired him. When I got to the car, she said, I started crying. The thing that disturbed me most is that I was judging him not because of his actions or because he isn't a good husband, but because he wasn't what I wanted him to be. From the book, Beloved Unbeliever. So C is conquest, H is hierarchy, A is authority, I is insight, R is relationship. Relationship shoulder to shoulder. The shoulder to shoulder friendship. He married you because you loved and liked him. Song of Solomon 5:1. God calls this couple friends, O lovers. I love it. Friends, O lovers. What I call lover friendship. God describes that couple as friends and lovers. Your husband married you because he thought you'd be his companion, his friend. And then she says about her husband, he's wholly desirable, in verse 16, this is my beloved and this is my friend. There was a time when you said we're best of friends and he saw you as his companion. But after marriage, it's been kind of documented that as those three children come, you move into exhaustion and the PMS issues, there are a lot of chemical things that do happen. I don't discount that at all. But a negativity comes over you. You know, women want the relationship to be more positive. Men want it to be less negative. It's true. That's just the way it goes down. That's the way it goes down. And so in the home, you become unfriendly. Unfriendly. That's why Titus 2 says the older women are to encourage the younger women to love their husbands and love their children. But that Greek word is not agape, as we pointed out. That is phileo. That she is to be friendly toward her husband and friendly toward her children. You ask the children, does your mommy love you? Yes. Does she like you? No, not today. We've been bad. Now notice it says you're to phileo your husband. That's the Greek. It didn't say fillet him. But I'll tell you, in courtship, you wanted to be with him, and he'd be playing an intramural basketball, and you came and watched him, and you cheered him on, and he thought that was always going to be the way this relationship was. You'd be there shoulder to shoulder with him. And then the children came. But his desires didn't change. He hasn't changed. But he has gone quiet. Just as you want a face-to-face relationship, and I encouraged him to do that as a man of honor, as a woman of love, I'm going to encourage you to do some shoulder-to-shoulder things with him without talking. Just being with him without talking. You know, women say the key to marriage is communication. Where does the Bible teach that? It does not. If anything, for women, it says inner quietness. Quietness is the key. You don't have to always talk to him to connect. In fact, he's energized by your mere presence, not by you talking. And when you're with him without talking, he then eventually probably will open up. But see, this makes no sense to women. But I'm going to tell you, there were things I said last night that made no sense to men about how to love you. Just, why do we keep talking about the same thing over and over again? Dr. Deborah Tannen did an interesting research. She had two 20-year-old women who were best of friends, two 16-year-old girls best of friends, two 12-year-olds, and two 6-year-old girls. And these were dyads, they called them. They were best of friends. And they would bring these two into a room. So she just brought the two 20-year-olds into a room, and there were two chairs, and that was it. And she said, be here, we'll come back. Well, these were best of friends. What did all the women and girls do in relationship to those two chairs? They either turned the chairs toward one another and crossed their legs and talked face to face, or they turned in the chairs, put their elbow on the rest, and talked face to face. All four dyads did that. That's what women do. the way God has made you. Not wrong, just different. Then she had two 20-year-old men, two 16-year-old boys, two 12-year-old boys, two 6-year-old boys. What did the men and boys do in relationship to those chairs except the 6-year-old boys who didn't sit in it? But we'll medicate them, don't worry. Just we'll calm them down. The men did not move the chairs, just sat looking straight ahead and periodically would look at one another and talk. Now, these were best of friends. Periodically could talk. And then, who had the most intimate of conversations, the men or the women? The 16-year-old boys did. And Dr. Deborah Tannen and her crew were stunned because the boys hardly even said anything as they sat there. And then, periodically, one would turn. And if you turned off the audio, you wouldn't know they were having a conversation. You turn on the audio, and what the one said to the other was so transparent, so revealing, it was unbelievable. But he didn't say a lot, and he didn't look a lot. But what he said was very transparent. You know, women have this idea that relationships have to be based on how they want relationships. That's why when guys go hunting, they go 3 days north, hunt, come back, and then the wife says, well, how was your time with Bob? Good. What'd you talk about? Nothing. You didn't ask Bob about Mary's pregnancy? Mary pregnant? Now, this isn't always about all your needs, ladies. I'm going to tell you, though, it's ultimately going to meet your needs because the way you energize your husband, eventually, as you just are with him shoulder to shoulder, he turns and says something so transparent you fall off the chair. But you got to give him time. You just give him time. You just be with him because energy goes into him shoulder to shoulder, not face to face always. Think of it that way. Energy goes into him when you are with him, just quietly with him. He has a need for that. There's just something in him that needs that. Is that okay? In fact, there was this couple who came. They had a huge fight because prior to the conference, he was painting outside and she was looking at him through the kitchen window. He says, come out here and be with me. So she came out with him and she started talking. He said, I don't want to talk. He said, you got to want to talk. I don't got to want to talk. You got to want to talk because you called me out here to be with you. I don't got to want to talk because I called you out here to be with me. And a huge fight, and she stomped off. Then she listened to what I just said. So then he was still painting after the conference. So then she brought out a lounge chair, sat down in a lounge chair, no suntan lotion, no book, and she just laid there and watched him as he was painting. She said it was stunning. She said nothing. For 45 minutes, she sat there, and then she got up and she said, that energized you, didn't it? He said, oh, you have no idea. And she told me she had no idea. She just could not. You're going to hear Sarah in a few minutes tell you some stories that are going to blow you away. This works, ladies, but you got to take it by faith. I remember growing up in Peoria and riding my bike up and down. It was blue-collar city, and guys were always working on their cars. And I can remember, right, and I had this flashback one day, that there was one woman who used to sit on a stool. She'd be doing her fingernails, smoking her cigarette, her lucky cigarette, I remember, and lipstick. And the guy was under the car, working on the car. And she'd just be sitting there, no other women around. And she wasn't talking, just sat there. She'd sit there for a couple hours, just doing her nails and everything. And then I remember, they didn't divorce. See, an energy was going into him. She wasn't formally educated, but she had wisdom. She knew he had a need. He wanted her to be there just with him. And then I remember there was no jack under the car. He was holding up with his chest. You're there, honey? Decode, is he reacting in unloving ways? It could be that he's feeling disrespected. You just don't like him. He's not your friend. You don't want to be with him because it's a waste of time. You have more important things to do. That's how he feels sometimes when you want to talk about the same thing over and over again. Let's stop passing judgment on one another. Your spouse has a need that you don't have. Is that okay? Receive it. Don't criticize it. And then lastly, sexuality. Proverbs 5:19, as a loving hind and a graceful doe, let her breast satisfy you at all times. Be exhilarated always with her love. Did you know there's no Bible verse that says, let his breast satisfy you at all times? You say, that is sick. Well, that's true, but also I see the obvious, and seemingly others don't. What this verse is saying is that men are visually oriented. Jesus said, I say to you that everyone who looks on a woman to lust for her has committed adultery with her already in his heart. Jesus acknowledges here that men are visually oriented, and you've got to be guarded. That's why Job made a covenant with his eyes not to look upon a virgin in that lustful way. But I'm going to share with you that your husband has a need for sexual release in the same way that you have a need for emotion release. And Paul says in 1 Corinthians 7, stop depriving one another except by agreement for a time that you may devote yourselves to prayer and come together again lest Satan tempt you because of your lack of self-control. Your husband has a need. You have a need. His anatomy, generally speaking, is not true for all men because we see that there are impotency issues in the culture, but your husband has a need, generally speaking, just as you have emotional needs. There are some women who shut down and don't want to talk, but these are the exceptions. My point is that, is it okay for him to have a need that you don't have? You know, early on, I'm going to believe this, that your husband saw you as his best friend. And he was at work, and somebody came to the drinking fountain, didn't have a bra on, and he got an eyeful, and his biology kicked into gear. And so he comes home to tell his best friend, his companion, man, can't believe it, that new gal that came on, she came to the drinking fountain, and he starts telling this with you, and you go ballistic. Why? Because you project onto him pink. Everything is interpreted through pink now. That you would never have sexual feelings toward anybody unless there's a lot of time together, a lot of talk, a lot of touch, a lot of tenderness. So you project that all onto him, fear comes over you, and you blast him with contempt. Because you are the determiner of truth. What you feel is the voice of God. The fact of the matter is, that's the first time he ever saw him, her. He doesn't know her name. Men respond to the visual. We don't like it. We didn't ask to be made this way. You have your chemical monthly issues that you have to understand. There's a metabolism in you that we can't relate with. Calm down, woman. So we can fire at one another all day long, and we can do so as long as we're only looking at it through pink and blue. I love judging you based on blue, and you love judging me based on pink, but we better start looking at it through purple. I'm going to tell you, he's visually oriented. Think of it when you step out of a shower and he's there, he just looks at you. Just being biblical, Proverbs 5:19. Now reverse it. When he steps out of a shower and you're there, get back in there. You're getting water. I just waxed that. Get a towel down here and get a towel around you. You're sick. Just a few male-female differences, folks. In conclusion, C-O-U-P-L-E. Jesus, the lover, is close with us, open with us, understands us. He makes peace with us. He's loyal to us. He esteems us. That's Jesus, the lover. But Christ the Lord, he's the coming conquering king. He's head over all. All authority has been given to him in heaven and earth. He has all insight, knowledge, and wisdom. He will relate to us in his terms, and he's planting a seed that will be born again into his family throughout eternity. That's Christ the Lord, Jesus the lover. Pink and blue together make purple. Together we reflect the image of God. Not wrong, just different. But together we reflect him. Let's close in prayer.
Testing, 1, 2. Testing, 1, 2. There it is. Bill, I love you, brother. Thank you so much. Now I understand what y'all was talking about earlier, but keep this in mind. That's coming from your spouse. Bill's my brother, okay? He can handle it. He's strong. He's 6'2". He can handle it. His spirit's strong. No, I'm just kidding. They are, oh, yeah. That's my brother. Hallelujah. Men, last week it was the ladies' video. Last week was the men's video. This week was the ladies' video. One thing he said, can you decode the other one? Yeah, it's a challenge sometimes, and it's an adventure sometimes. But if we work on our relationship and we learn to decode what's really going on, men has needs, women has needs. If we take the time and operate and function in a manner that's pleasing to God and work on our relationships, it's a wonderful place to be. Sometimes there will be friction. Sometimes there will be struggles. Sometimes there will be things that you have to work on to get over and overcome. But we got to learn to hear what's going on. My wife, I know one of the things I've recently caught on to is she wants to disconnect. When she's yelling, screaming, and hollering at me, it's not she's wanting to control. I've always thought it was control. No, she just wants to connect. She wants to be a part of what I'm doing. She wants to be face-to-face. I just want to be shoulder-to-shoulder. Nothing wrong with that. It's just the different makeup that we are. And sometimes I have to give in to her needs and be face-to-face and look at her eye-to-eye and make her smile to the best of my ability. And sometimes she's got to give in to my needs and be shoulder-to-shoulder and just be there quietly. We're working on that one. But see, it's all about working on your relationship, are you? Take some time. Okay, process the video a little while. Process last week's video. Like I said, if you need to go online and you can find it, we will send it to you. It's very important, the love and respect thing. I really like the way he presented this. He did a lot better job than I ever could because he studied it for years and years. He wrote the book on it, and I figured him presenting it to you would have been a lot better than me presenting it to you or my wife presenting it to you. I felt that he would really get some points across that we all need to understand. And sometimes that's why past relationships haven't worked. It's because we didn't work on them. And now here we are coming together to try and work on our relationship. And I encourage you to go home tonight. Everything from this day backwards, just repent of it. Ask for forgiveness. Put it behind you and begin to work on it from this day forward. Now for men, that's easy to do. Men have no trouble forgetting the past. But men, we also have to understand for ladies, they're connected to it. And we may have to process a few of those things and allow them to talk about a few of those things and allow them to have their voice to be said, to connect with us, to find the reason why they fell in love with us. There's one question on that white piece of paper. When you first met me, what did you think? I started to ask my wife that. I ain't done it yet, but I'm going to. Because one time, and this has really floored me, and I close with this because we're past our time, but it really floored me. She didn't know how it responded to me, but there was a while back that she went and was a part of a chrysalis for the teenagers. She got to go speak. It's like Walk to Emmaus. It's a special retreat for teenagers, and she didn't know this at the time, but she was getting ready for her speech or her talk, and part of it was she was to share her testimony. And I asked her one night to be reading her testimony, and she started talking about when she met me, how handsome I was. That was when I had hair and all that. And I was thinking to myself, man, that's good. I didn't know you loved me. I didn't know you cared. She doesn't remember. She remembers the situation. I never told her my response, man. Hey, we don't have feelings. But oh, when she spoke, it just uplifted me. And it blessed me to hear her talk about me and encourage me, you know? Now, sometimes I miss that. And her response today is, so many people talk about how good you are and this and that, and I just don't, you know? And she said, I can't compete with all that. I said, yeah, but, you know, 100 people can say how much they love me, but when you say it, it really means more. Okay? And she doesn't understand because she does compete a lot. Because I deal with a lot of hundreds of people, but when it comes from her, it's so much different than a brother. It's so much different than a sister. When it comes from her, it means a lot. And we need to encourage one another in all that we do. One of the things that he spoke, and I know I was going to close, I'll close with this one. One of the things he said, here's the key. Men and women, ladies, if we was on the Titanic ship, and it was about to go down, would your man say, women and children first into the life rafts? And you ladies, I know you. I'm sorry. But you say, yes, dear, we'll see you later. I'm going in a life raft. I'm getting out of here. Yes, no problem. We love you. We'll see you. But us men, we're going down with the ship. That's the makeup in which God created us. We're willing to sacrifice our lives for you because you're special unto us. And we understand. We really do. But I know some of you ladies in the rights movement,
I want my rights.
For men, it's not about rights. It's about responsibility. We're responsible for you. And we want to make sure you're safe. We want to make sure you have what you need and your needs are met. And to us, when we meet your needs, hey, we've done our part. Let's go watch the, you know, football game. You know, that's how we feel. Did you get anything out of us tonight? Yeah. Amen. Praise the Lord. Want to encourage you tonight when you go home just to think about it. Decode one another for a moment. Take some time. Spend some time with each other. Allow some couch time to happen and talk about the video. I believe you'll be blessed. Can we bow our heads for a close of prayer? Father, we just exalt you tonight. We praise you. We thank you for your presence here tonight. And we thank you for your love, your joy, and your peace. Father, we thank you for the words that were spoken about chairs. And Father, we just exalt you. We ask you to allow your love, your joy, and your peace to flow in all of our hearts as we get ready to go from here. Allow your hand of protection to be upon us all until we can return again into your house. Lord, we exalt you, we praise you, and we give you all the glory. For it's in Jesus' name we pray, and all that would agree would say, amen, amen. Amen. May God bless you and God be with you, and we'll see you next Wednesday night as we continue on this journey. Hello there.